BNP Paribas, one of Europe's largest banks, reports 2017 third quarter results. Jean-Laurent Bonnafé, hello, welcome.
Thank you.
You are the CEO of BNP Paribas. What are the highlights of the group's third quarter results?
In the third quarter 2017, BNP Paribas showed good business activity, but faced an unfavorable context for market activities. Revenues were slightly lower due to an adverse forex effect, but were actually stable at constant scope and exchange rates. Domestic markets revenues were slightly down due to the low rates environment despite good business development. IFS revenues were actually significantly higher on a comparable basis, while CIB's revenues were impacted by the unfavorable market context for global markets. Costs were well under control thanks to the continued implementation of the operating efficiency measures. CIB's costs were down, benefiting from the launch of CIB transformation plan at the beginning of 2016. IFS cost evolution reflected the increased levels of activity, while domestic markets were higher on the back of the continued development of the specialized businesses, with, however, a decrease on average for the three main retail networks. The group's cost of risk was again at a low level this quarter, standing at 36 basis points. This low level of cost of risk derived from the continued decrease at BNL, combined with write-backs in some businesses. One-off items of the quarter included the €326 million capital gain on the sale of a 4% stake in SBI Life in India. However, overall, they were negligible in the third quarter. In Q3 2017, the group delivered a good level of net income, which stood at €2 billion, up 8.3% compared to last year. Excluding one-offs, it was 6.7% below last year's, penalized by the adverse exchange rate effect I mentioned. If we take the first 9 months of the year, the group has already generated a solid €6.3 billion of net result on the back of a good operating performance. In annualized terms, this equates to a return on equity of 9.8% and a return on tangible equity of 11.6%. In terms of financial structure, the sound profitability of the third quarter, net of 50% dividend payout, helped the fully loaded common equity Tier 1 ratio progress by 10 basis points versus last quarter to stand at 11.8% at the end of September. To sum up, the group delivered a good level of income this quarter and a good operating performance in the first 9 months of the year.
Eurozone countries are showing a robust pace of growth and the outlook remains good. How have your domestic markets fared in this environment?
Domestic markets showed good business drive in the third quarter on the back of robust economic growth, as you said. We saw good loan growth in all the networks and in the specialized businesses, as well as a continued increase in deposits in all countries. The assets under management of our private banking confirmed a good trend, marking a 5.8% increase compared to last year. And Hello Bank has continued to attract new clients, especially in France, where they were up 18% compared to last year, and in Italy, up 17% year on year. In terms of P&L, third quarter revenues were almost flat at €3.9 billion. As I mentioned, we saw good business drive in our domestic markets, but we continued to be impacted by the low interest rate environment. Commission income marked an increase in all the networks. Operating costs were moderately higher due to business development investments in our specialized businesses. Taking just the three large retail networks, costs were actually down 0.1% on average. Given the continued reduction in cost of risk at BNL in Italy, pre-tax income stood at close to €1 billion, only slightly below last year's level. In conclusion, our domestic markets fared quite well in the quarter, showing good business drive while still reflecting the low interest rate environment.
Looking beyond the Eurozone to your international retail banking, what are the highlights of the third quarter?
Starting with Euromed, business activity continued to show good growth, with loans up in all regions and deposits also marking good progress. The successful development of our digital banks in this area was confirmed. In fact, Septetab in Turkey already has over 440,000 clients, and BGZ Optima in Poland, with its 205,000 clients, is the leading digital savings bank in the country. At constant scope and exchange rates, revenues were down 3.7% due to the impact of higher rates on deposits in Turkey, which have not yet been offset by the gradual loans repricing. The other regions progressed well on the back of good volume growth. Costs increased as a result of the good business development. Overall, Given a lower cost of risk, Euromed's pre-tax income was up 7.3% in the third quarter of this year. At historical scope and exchange rates, it actually showed a 4% reduction due to unfavorable forex evolution. Moving to US retail banking, BankWest confirmed its strong business drive. Loans were up over 6%, driven by both individuals and corporate lending, while deposits were up 9% compared to last year. On a comparable basis, the assets under management of our private banking marked a further progress of 13% on last year to stand at $13 billion. And on the digital front, the users of BankWest online services already exceed 410,000. BankWest also continued to foster cross-business cooperation with other group businesses such as CIB, Leasing Solutions and Personal Finance. At constant scope and exchange rates, revenues were up 6%, essentially on the back of good volume growth. Costs were kept well under control, and BankWest generated a largely positive jaws effect in the quarter. On the whole, BankWest pre-tax income increased by 9.5% on last year, confirming a strong operating performance in the third quarter. It was up 3.4% at historical scope and exchange rates due to the unfavorable FX evolution.
Personal Finance is a leader in personal financing in France and in Europe. How has this business performed in a context of growth across European countries?
Personal Finance delivered another quarter marked by very good business drive. Outstanding loans were up 8.8% thanks to the higher demand in the Eurozone on the back of the favorable economic backdrop and the positive effect of new partnerships. In Q3, Personal Finance signed new commercial agreements, as for example with the telecom operator MassMobile in Spain and with MediaWorld in Italy, a multimedia and home appliances firm. It also forged ahead with its digital development, as shown for example by the fact that in Spain, e-signatures already represent more than 70% of the agreements, whereas in Belgium, Personal Finance has just released the e-signature QuickSign. In terms of results, revenues were up 3.9% on the back of volume growth combined with a shift towards products offering a better risk profile. Revenues progressed particularly well in Italy and in Spain. Costs progressed on the back of the increased level of activity. Cost of risk was at a low level and pre-tax income reached €420 million, up 2.2% on last year. In conclusion, in a context of solid growth in Europe, Personal Finance continued to show a very dynamic business drive in the third quarter of the year.
How have your assets under management evolved in the third quarter of the year, and how have your savings businesses progressed? Also, what can you tell us about the recent IPO of SBI Life in India, which drew strong demand and was the biggest in the country in 7 years?
The group's total assets under management stood at €1,041 billion at the end of September, thanks to good net asset inflows in all our businesses and a positive performance effect, which was only partly offset by an unfavorable foreign exchange effect. In fact, over the past 11 quarters, our assets under management have increased by €147 billion, with nearly two-thirds coming from net asset inflows. Taking the insurance business first, it continued to show solid business development with good net inflows, especially in unit-linked policies. As you mentioned, noteworthy this quarter was the successful IPO of SBI Life in India. Through our insurance subsidiary Cardiff, we had a 26% stake in the company and we took the opportunity to sell a 4% stake, which generated a €326 million capital gain in the third quarter accounts. Insurance revenues were a tad lower, but in the comparison, one must consider the high level of capital gains booked in Q3 of last year. The business marked a good performance in protection activity as well as in savings activity in France and in Asia. Costs were up due to the continued development of the business and overall, after accounting for the SBI Life capital gain, pre-tax income marked a strong increase to stand at €740 million in the third quarter. Turning to wealth asset management, it also showed good business activity in all its business lines. As part of the group's ambition program of new customer experience and digital transformation, the asset management business has acquired a majority stake in Gambit Financial Solutions. This leading European provider of robo-advisory investment solutions will in fact help us transform client journeys with investment advisory solutions and digitalization of customers' interfaces. In terms of P&L, Wealth and asset management revenues progressed by 4.9% despite an adverse forex effect. At constant scope and exchange rates, revenues were up 8.3% with a positive contribution from all the business lines. Costs marked a slight reduction, leading to a largely positive jaws effect. As a result, pre-tax income marked a near 30% improvement to stand at €208 million in the third quarter. To wrap up, strong income growth in our insurance business on the back of the capital gain on the sale of a 4% stake in SBI Life and a very good overall performance in our wealth and asset management in Q3.
The lackluster market activity during the summer doesn't bode well for CIB's revenues in the third quarter. How have your CIB business lines fared in this context?
Our CIB confirmed good commercial dynamics this quarter, but was impacted by the lackluster market context, as you said. Revenues stood at €2.7 billion, down 8.5% compared to a high comparison base in Q3 of last year and impacted by an unfavorable foreign exchange effect. At constant scope and exchange rates, they were down 5.9%. Taking the business lines one at a time, global markets revenues were lower, marking a 14.6% contraction at constant scope and exchange rates as FICC activity was affected by the challenging market conditions. Indeed, FICC saw lower client activity across the board in Q3 in contrast with the favorable market context of the corresponding period of last year, resulting in a 23.6% decrease in revenues. In this lackluster context, we confirm our top ranking on all bond issues in euros and number 9 position for international bond issues. Equities revenues, on the other hand, showed good growth of 9.4% on the back of a sound performance of prime services and equity derivatives. Looking at security services, revenue progressed by 4.2% on the back of growing outstandings and higher transactions level. Security services continued to gain significant new mandates. Finally, corporate banking revenues were a tad lower due to an adverse forex effect. At constant scope and exchange rates, they progressed by 2.1%, with growth in the Asia-Pacific region as well as progress in the EMEA area. Transaction banking marked good growth. It consolidated its leading position in trade finance in Europe and was ranked among the top three in Asia for the first time. Turning to total CIB costs, this showed again a significant reduction of -6.2% year-on-year and -3.3% on a comparable basis on the back of the cost efficiency measures that we've been implementing in the CIB division since 2016. On the digital front, CIB has identified 200 processes that could be automatized by the end of next year. Cost of risk marked a small net write-back this quarter. As a result, CIB generated €778 million of pre-tax income, down just 4.2% compared to last year. So to sum up, our corporate and institutional banking showed in a lackluster market context a resilient performance thanks to its continuing cost reduction effort.
What progress have you made since the launch of your 2020 plan regarding new customer experience and digital transformation?
All group businesses are actively developing new customer experiences as well as digital transformation. Starting with domestic markets in France, back in May, we released LifePay jointly with Crédit Mutuel and in partnership with leading French retail groups. This new high-value added app provides a universal mobile payment solution combining payment, loyalty programs, coupons and discount offers. Still in France, we've launched a new digital corporate onboarding app called Welcome and BNP Paribas Factor has released Finci, which is a fully digital receivables finance solution geared for SMEs and mid-sized businesses. In Italy, we are gradually expanding the digital service of chatbots. These provide self-care services dealing with generic inquiries from clients and are available round the clock every day. We've also taken steps to digitalize corporate client subsidiaries onboarding with the new solution called My Accounts at One Bank. In Belgium, we are launching with several Belgian partners the It's Me app, which is a mobile digital ID allowing for secure authentication and approval of transactions on the internet. Finally, for domestic markets, I remind you that back in July, we also finalized the acquisition of Compte Nickel in France. With the addition of Compte Nickel, we now have in our French retail banking four distinct offers, that correspond to differentiated service models adapted to our clients' different expectations and needs. Looking at international financial services now, I've already mentioned the acquisition of Gambit, which will help us improve client journeys with investments, robo-advisory solutions, and digitalization of customers' interfaces. In personal finance, we're going to take our Hello Bank concept one step further by launching new digital banks in Europe, leveraging our ZLM client base. These new digital banks will slot in alongside the existing Hello Bank that we operate in our domestic markets in 5 countries. The first launch is expected soon in the Czech Republic. Turning to CIB, this division has been pressing ahead with its industrial and digital transformation, as illustrated by the ongoing development of its Centric platform. This seamless online platform, which is now available in 40 countries, provides our corporate customers with a comprehensive offer of e-banking services. Centric has been steadily gaining clients and has today already 7,700 clients. Another example of the digital transformation we are implementing in CIB is the preparation of the rollout of Symphony in global markets after we took a minority stake in this company, which provides a communication and workflow automation tool to enhance digital interaction with clients. As you can see through this example, the group is making good progress regarding the implementation of its new customer experience and digital transformation plan.
And finally, you recently pledged to stop financing shale and oil sands projects, further expanding your commitments in support of global efforts to tackle climate change. What's the thinking behind this?
This represents a further step to accelerate the group's support of the energy transition and is part of our philosophy to be a responsible actor in the society. As you mentioned, BNP Paribas will no longer do business with companies focused on oil and gas from Shell and oil from tar sands operations. Likewise, the group will no longer finance projects that are mainly involved in the transportation and export of oil and gas from shale and oil from tar sands, as well as cease any financing of oil and gas exploration or production projects in the Arctic region. These far-reaching measures will reinforce the actions already taken by the group to combat climate change, which include, amongst others, a target of 15 billion euros in financing for renewable energy projects by 2020. To wrap up, we are a long-standing partner to the energy sector and we're determined to support the transition to a more sustainable world. I'm convinced that a major bank financing economic development in the 21st century must, as a world citizen, act for energy transition.
Jean-Laurent Bonnafé, CEO of BNP Paribas, thank you very much.
You're welcome.